stand on up. Let's stand on up. Lord God, we thank you so much. Right now, just enter into prayer. Lord God, you are the strength. You are the hope. Lord God, when nothing else is going right around us, when the enemies are on all sides, when my own mistakes and actions have caused me to stumble, Lord God, you are my joy. You are my strength. You are my hope. Your mercies are made new every single day. And it is with that, Lord God, we can worship you. It is with that, Lord God, we can lift our eyes, that we can be bold and just come into your presence. And we thank you so much. I pray, Lord God, that you encourage us with your word today. Lord God, encourage us. Wrap your arms around us. Challenge us. Whatever it is you need to do to get through to this, whatever I am to you right now, Lord God, whatever is struggling, Lord God, let your word get through. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Amen. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. It is great to be with you here this morning. You can be seated. Welcome. Great to see all of you. And I love to greet everyone online, wherever you are this morning. Thank you for tuning in. And Bishop and Janine, good morning. And I hope you're having a great time wherever God is leading you this morning. And thank you for the opportunity to come and bring part two to my message from last week. You guys ready? Couple of questions. I need to do this just to kind of modify my teaching a little bit. How many of you were here last week? Because I know the snow and everything. Raise your hands if you were here last week. Wow, a lot of people were not here last week. How many of you were here on the first when Bishop launched Renewing the Vision? Raise your hands. Okay. How many of you were here for the last 2 weeks? Ooh. How many of you, even though you were not here, you have watched it online and you are caught up sitting here this morning? Look at those hits. That is incredible. I love that. Bishop, if you didn't see, a lot of hands went up. They're watching online when they can't make it here. So that's why we have that there. So that is very encouraging. So with that being said, I think it's just natural that I do a little bit of a recap with you. Is that okay? Just gonna recap just a little bit, which will probably be a lot because a lot has been happening and going on. And the most important thing right now, I think, for us as a church is that we really embrace what we call a theme, but part of me hesitates calling it a theme for this year because it's so much more. I believe it is the heart and the direction that God has for us this year as a church. And just so you know, when I say as a church, I mean us. What he has for us as an individual, as a family, as a single, as a member of Kingdom Life Christian Church. So it may take a while for us to truly start embracing and walking in what God is speaking and trying to do through us. And guess what? That's okay, because our God is patient. Am I right? God is patient with us. So Bishop on the first of the year, brought forth a word called renewing the vision. And with that, if you haven't heard it, I ask you to and plead with you, if you consider yourself part of this ministry, find some time, go online, click on to watch, hit archives, and it's right over there with Bishop on January 1st, renewing the vision, and listen to the word that he brought in the heart that he has for this church and what God is putting on him for this church and what God is trying to speak to this church. But if I can just bring up about a couple of the main points of what he spoke about, the biggest thing, and I talked about this last week in detail, was how he, Bishop came up here and he said, there is a shifting of anointing and responsibility to us, the church. Let me repeat that again. Bishop said that God has put on his heart, as he's pressing through and as a senior leader, to hear from God on behalf of his people, on behalf of this church. And God said that we are in a season where God wants to now shift the anointing and the responsibility of kingdom life from Bishop and the leadership, the presbytery, the pastors, to us, the people. All of you sitting down, all of you listening online. And that is an extraordinary statement. It's an extraordinary word. And then he said, the next 5 years will tell whether or not we as a church grab hold of this word or not. And if we do, the vision of God, the new season of God, is going to launch within this place. And if not, we'll probably just be a good church. There's going to be encouragement. There's going to be ministry. There'll be good things. But the relevant church that God is desiring to have throughout the world, we probably won't be part of that. Sobering statement. So I was taken back by all of this and like, wow, God, is this real? Is this true? Because I don't know about you, it's easier to sit down and hear what I need to do, right? Than actually try to figure it out myself. Am I right? How many of you, like, when you think about purpose or what you're gonna do in your life, don't you wish God would just tell you clearly? Or don't you wish, like, you can come and talk, like, teenagers throughout the years have always come to me, Pastor Mark, I'm trying to figure out my purpose. And then they walk away more confused than when they came. They're like, you were no help. I'm like, I'm encouraging you. There's a lot of different roads to Rome, you know, but get there. I don't want to hear it. I want to hear exactly what I'm, boom. And sometimes that happens, but a lot of times we got, so God's saying us taking hold of the vision, that the anointing and the responsibility is on us. So we talked about that and saying, and just asking us ourselves the question of, if that is honestly what God is saying, which I am saying that is what God's saying, because I'm in this house, I trust my leadership that God is speaking this, and plus, we can go in the word and find it all throughout the Bible, reiterated over and over again, that this is God's heart for his people. Okay? That's why he gives us all the Holy Spirit. There's not just the temple, okay, that holds the Holy of Holies anymore, but that the Holy Spirit's in all of us because this is God's heart. So with that being said, what does that mean for us today in this season? What does that mean? What does it look like? Then how am I now part of this house of kingdom life accomplishing the vision? God, what's the anointing you want to place on my life? And what do I need to do then to be appointed to carry out that vision, that anointing? And that appointment usually comes with the responsibility that Bishop was talking about. I was like, okay. How many of you have kids, when they get a certain age, some houses, like 5 years old, they already got a whole list of chores. They're like, yeah, we don't play around in our house. Our kid's gonna shoot. 5 years old, kids mopping. I'm like, wow, that's incredible. Okay? But for most of us, there's a certain age where it's like, no. You're part of this family. No more freebies. There's some chores, there's some responsibilities because you're part of this house. Does that make sense? So wouldn't it be natural that God has that same mentality with his house? Okay, so then let me continue. All right? So then the question is, and what I talked about is now it's time for us to own the vision. It's time for us to own the vision. Are you ready to be part owner? Well, what if Robert Kraft, who is the owner of the Patriots, New England Patriots, any Patriot fans in the house? Yeah, some haters in the house. People hate greatness. It's natural. It's just, okay? It's just the way it is, okay? So how about if Robert Kraft gave you a 5% stake in the New England Patriots, part ownership? Would you get excited? Would you expect some season tickets? Okay, would you expect some say in the business activities? Okay? God's saying you're part owner. God's saying you're an ambassador of the kingdom. Jesus said, and this is what I shared last week, Jesus said that I confer on you a kingdom. Just as my Father conferred one on me, which is found in Luke 22, verse 29. And that word confer means to bestow or to grant upon. So Jesus is saying, I'm bestowing upon us. He's bestowing upon me and you the kingdom of God. Wow. So that's why it makes sense that Bishop's like, okay, I'm conferring upon you Kingdom Life Christian Church. Just like the Father gave it to me 25 years ago. And some of you have been part of, you've been running with it, you know, but it's a new season with the bigger picture. So, man, what does that look like? So, Jesus has given us ownership to his house, to his kingdom. Okay? Our names are on the deed. Amazing. And I shared a story at the end of last week where I said there was three bricklayers. You guys remember this? Three bricklayers building a wall, laying brick. A guy came by and said to the first one, what are you doing? So what does it look like I'm doing? What kind of stupid question is that? Laying brick. One at a time, laying brick. What do you mean? Dumb question. He said, all right, forget you. Went to the next guy. Said, how about you? What are you doing? What do you mean, what am I doing? I'm building a wall. Can't you see? It's going to be a wall. Said, all right. Then he went to the next person and said, what are you doing? And he was just enthusiastically just exclaimed, man, I'm building a cathedral for God. You see the difference between the three? Question is, who are we in that story? We just putting bricks up there with no purpose? Do we kind of see a little bit of it? Got a little purpose of the wall? Or do we have a vision of what God is doing? And are we now a part of that? Are we taking the ownership of it? Even though it might just be just some little bricks. But man, I want to be the one that is building the kingdom of God. And so we talked last week about Nehemiah. Pastor Dave spoke about it. Athena spoke about it before the special. Talking about Nehemiah. And let me just couple background things because we're going to get more into Nehemiah today. Old Testament. So if you want to bring your Bibles, you can go to Nehemiah now. You can prepare yourself. Okay? And so Nehemiah, back in the day, this is before, you know, I mean, way back. So this was when Babylonian came and captured and seized Jerusalem, and there was exiles, there were captives, okay? They destroyed the city, okay? All this stuff was happening, and Nehemiah was actually born in captivity, which basically just means he wasn't born in Jerusalem or Israel. He was actually born in modern day Iran, in the Persian Empire, and he was now a cupbearer to the king of Persia. So he was part of the high court. He had a great job. He was a nobleman. He served the king and had the king's ear, like Pastor Dave spoke about. Okay? And then on top of that, he heard a story. Somebody came, and it says in the beginning of Nehemiah, they told him that Jerusalem was breached. The walls were destroyed. The gates were destroyed. It was rubble, okay, fire, okay. And now Jerusalem was vulnerable because we know that the walls are to protect. Whatever it is you need to protect, that's what the walls are protecting. And this, the walls are protecting God's holy city, Jerusalem, okay? The temple of the Lord. Now, without going into a lot of history, he started to mourn and he wept. It said he wept for days. And then it said he prayed and he fasted. He prayed and he fasted. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. But after he prayed and fasted, the Lord gave him a vision. And with that vision, he shared it with the king. And the king allowed him to go to Jerusalem to rebuild this wall. And in 52 days, an extraordinary accomplishment, he built the wall. Incredible. Okay, so today I want to get deeper into this story and talk about the five keys of accomplishing the vision together. Okay, because Nehemiah didn't do it alone. Nehemiah didn't go there and build. He didn't hire a couple people. It says that the people of Israel, all the people, from the priests to the noblemen to all the different tribes, all the different people, they came together and they built this wall together. They embraced the vision of God and they went forth and they did an extraordinary thing in 52 days. So with that being said, today, let's talk about how we actually do it together. Okay, we want to own the vision. Okay, I'm a member here at Kingdom Life. Okay, I want to do something. Okay, I hear the vision, but what does that mean to me? Let's read about it. And I think if we look inside Nehemiah, there's a lot of stuff we can glean and learn from that. Are you guys ready? Ready, okay. So the first thing of coming together, okay, to accomplish the vision together is we need to press in through prayer. We need to press through in prayer. And now you're like, oh, man. Once again, Pastor Mark giving me these simple, ordinary answers. We want like real keys. Pastor Mark, I don't know what college to go to, what I'm supposed to do. Pray. Oh, man. That's the worst answer in the world. Oh. And you just walk away. Okay? But how many of you watched the national championship game on Monday night? Anybody? A couple people? How many of you have no idea what I'm talking about? Raise your hand. All right. That's okay. All right. How many of you heard of something called football? How many of you know there's not just the NFL? Okay? There is something else on TV, college football. It's a big deal, okay, for some of us. Okay, not all of us. All right, so Alabama played Clemson. And just so you know, if there's a David and Goliath story, this is pretty much almost a David and Goliath story. Alabama's like the greatest. I mean, New England Patriots don't have nothing on Alabama. That's how incredible they are. And they were talking about them being the greatest team ever. And last year, they met in the championship, and Alabama beat them. It was a good game. Clemson almost won, but didn't happen. And then now a rematch, which normally doesn't happen in college football, where there's a rematch of a championship game. But long story short, they win the game, and afterwards they're talking, okay, to the head coach. And as he's being interviewed, he loves the Lord. He's born again. He has an incredible story. Go online. You can hear his testimony, and you can watch videos on his testimony. He gives it at churches and everywhere else, okay? So the thing he says when they said, how did you do this? How did you get your team to believe and to actually win the championship? When you came here 8 years ago, Clemson was garbage. How did you make them national championships? And he said, this is what I did. You guys ready? This is good. You ready? See, Nick's ready. Okay, he said, I taught them how to do the ordinary things in an extraordinary way. How to do the ordinary things in an extraordinary way. And he said, if you do that, you will have success and the world will take notice. You will have success and the world will take notice. If you can do the ordinary things in an extraordinary way, you will hear from God and the king will take notice. The kingdoms of this world will take notice. Your spouse would take notice. Your family would take notice. Your coworkers would take notice. So what was the first thing Nehemiah did when he heard about what was going on in Jerusalem? He prayed. He fasted. He did an ordinary thing, but he did it in such an extraordinary way. See, prayer conceived out of a godly burden will give birth to a vision. Will give birth to revelation. Prayer, conceived out of a godly burden, will give birth to a vision, will give birth to God's revelation. So when we talk about vision, vision is simply, especially in the context of God, vision is God revealing himself to us, in his kingdom to us. He's revealing it to us. Big scope, small scope. Personally, corporately. And we're talking about corporately this morning. So, what does that look like? Prayer conceived out of a godly burden will give birth to a vision. This is where I believe you could also, Lauren was talking about this on Wednesday night, your passions and how, man, if you can tap into your passion, you'll find that vision. But some of us, we don't have any passion. Or I can go, we have passion and we have vision. It's just not godly passion or godly vision. How do we get that? Prayer. And I'm not talking about, and I said this last week, the simple prayer that, you know, we see something happening and we see Aleppo and we'll pray, oh God, touch the people, you know, in Aleppo and all the refugees and being attacked, those that have lost children and the mothers that are now widows, Lord God, we pray, you know, and then tomorrow we don't pray about that. But if it's something we love, if it's something that touches home, like what if your son was in the hospital dying? Is it a 5-minute prayer? Or do you now have an extraordinary prayer life and you're pressing in? And my thing is that's where vision is birthed in us. So when we talk about kingdom life, when we talk about the 7 pillars, I encouraged all of you last week and I still encourage you, go online, click on the what about and you'll look and you'll be able to read the vision, the mission statement, what we believe, but you can look at the 7 pillars is what Bishop came with 25 years ago, these 7 pillars. Which one do you connect to? Which one will you pray for over and over again? See, some of us, man, we pray for kids And we just pray for children, not our children. Guess what? That's where God will birth a vision in your life. It's for children. Whether to be intercessor alone, which is somebody that continually prays on behalf of someone or something in a supernatural way, or God will birth in you strategy, direction, gift you in order to now go into that area and serve downstairs in the children's ministry. When you're in your neighborhood, you just have in this favor and anointing with little kids, God-given. Does that make sense? So we pray for God to answer the prayer, but God wants us to be the answer. See, we want, God, I pray for, and God said, are you willing to be the answer? That's the extraordinary part, that heart part, if you're willing to be the answer to your prayer. What does this look like? Let me just read with you really quickly. I can talk about this all morning. St. Francis of Assisi, an amazing priest back in the day from Italy, from Assisi's and St. Francis of Assisi's. Okay, this was his prayer. Many of you have heard this before, but he said, Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning, forgiving, that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born again to eternal life. Wow. His whole prayer is, God, let me not seek to be the receiver, but let me give, let me sow, let me be the one that answers the prayers on this earth as I sow into people. Powerful. You know, Wednesday we're talking about vision to the youth, and the thing I told them is that, see, the thing about a godly vision and why it's so necessary in our lives compared to the vision you have for your life that may or may not be vision, it could be goal setting, it could be a whole bunch of different things, is that a vision of God makes an imprint on eternity. It makes an imprint on eternity where our self-desired goals or vision, it might even leave a legacy. I might have that vision to make so much money and have such a successful business that I'm able to leave it to my children, but guess what? It doesn't make an imprint on eternity. Don't get me wrong. A godly business can make an imprint on eternity. It's a difference compared to just a selfish desire of a vision compared to one birth from God. I don't know about you. I want my vision. I want the things that I'm doing to make an imprint on all of eternity. I want it to ring true forever. Is that something you can say amen to? Amen. So God wants to reveal himself to us. See, God wants us to get in the game. We might be a New England Patriot fan. See, I'm a Dallas Cowboy fan, okay? So, come on, Dallas. You know, God is a Cowboy fan, all right? He just is, okay? You can say boo all you want, okay? Devil says boo too. All right, But here's the thing. If they win today, I'm going to be excited, okay? I'm going to be cheering. My wife's like, because I'm pretty even keel on mostly everything. You know, my wife would come home, be like, baby, I won the lottery for $200,000. I'm like, oh, that's cool. Really good. What are we going to do with it? You know, it hasn't happened. No, it hasn't happened. I'm just using that as a fictitious example. Okay? So, but I'm like, oh, that's cool. All right. That's nice. But when Dallas is on and, you know, whether it's a drop pass or a touch, I'm like, oh, yeah. And Lauren's like, why for them and nothing else? You know? I'm like, man, I don't know. Okay? So I already told her. We both have off tomorrow. I said, baby, here's the deal. If Dallas wins, tomorrow we're on the couch all day watching sports TV. We're listening to everybody's opinion about the cut. And then I was like, but if they lose, whatever you want to do. TV is off. We're out of the house because I don't want to hear anybody's 2 cents about nothing. Okay? But my point is I can get excited about the Cowboys. Okay? As that fan sitting in the seats, cheering them on. But God's saying, I want you on the team. I want you in the game. I want you to suit up, Marco. Okay? Now, I might want to be the quarterback, right? I'm like, oh, I'm the quarterback of this. And Bishop's like, okay, son. Go over there, line up on the offensive line, block me, okay? Take a beating because I'm the quarterback of this. Okay, I'm like, okay. But the truth still is, okay, when the confetti drops, I'm part of it, okay? It's me, okay? I'm getting the ring, all right? I'm getting the ring. Now, God wants us in the game. Are you willing to get into the game? Are you willing to get into the game, okay? Are you willing to ask God, what team do you want me on? A lot of different teams around here. What team do you want me on, God? Okay? So God wants to reveal himself, his ways and his plans to us. Okay? He wants to. It's God's heart. So repeat after me. Say, God wants to reveal himself to me. Now close your eyes. I usually don't do this, but close your eyes and say, my God, my Lord, my Savior, my King wants to reveal himself. He wants to talk to me. He wants to show me his kingdom. He wants to show me the plans to his kingdom. He wants to show me my part, my role, my responsibility in the kingdom of God, specifically in kingdom life. That's what God wants to do. If you don't hear anything else of what I have to share today, take that home with you. And I'm looking at the time, and I'm like, wow. All right, let's go. Are you ready? All right, so the second thing, we need the favor of God. If we have a vision from God, then we need the favor. And when God gives us a vision, he will give us the favor to accomplish it. When God gives us a divine heavenly vision, he will give us the favor to accomplish it. You can bring it to the bank guaranteed with Nehemiah. Okay? In Nehemiah 2, verses 1 through 9, you can read this later. Okay? Nehemiah gets the blessing of the king to rebuild the wall. Like Pastor Dave was saying before, he was nervous because he could have been taken out. There is documented things throughout history. They just took out anybody that came sad with a down face before the king. So he went trembling before the king in fear of his life. And like that, he had favor from the king of Persia. An unsaved, worldly king. He got favor. And this favor wasn't just to be released to go do it. Nehemiah got bold. Nehemiah said, hey, why don't you also write a letter that I can go to the guy that's over the forest, okay? And he'll, and we can just take as many trees as we want to build the wall. And he said, no problem, draft it up, put a seal on it, take it with you. And then what I love, I just have to turn to this. I believe it's verse 8. It says, so I went to the governors of the Trans-Euphrates and gave them the king's letters. Okay? And then it says, the king had also sent my officers. Well, the king had also sent army officers and cavalry with me. He went above and beyond. He didn't ask for. And here's the thing. Normally, if you get an escort, you get a couple like foot soldiers. You know what I mean? You ever see the movies, right? When they're walking with whatever, especially back in the day, they got the carriage and there's just a couple soldiers. And they always take the carriage and the stuff in it because the soldiers aren't nothing. Man, there was officers, army officers with the cavalry that went with Nehemiah. Favor. God's favor. So when we have vision, there's favor. Man, we can talk, and you guys have heard this from this house, the story of kingdom life, how it was birthed, and the extreme favor on this house. I remember a teenager, because I always tell our teenagers during the front row, you got to go through the membership class. I don't care you were born here. Go through the membership class. So I see my boy Bryce is like, I went through it, okay? Dave's like, I'm a founding member. I was born here. I'm not. You got to go too, okay? So I always tell the teenagers, you got to go through the membership class because I want them to hear this story. Because they never heard, you never heard it from the pulpit the way Bishop talks about it at membership class. Okay, so afterwards, this young man comes to me and he was like, and I was like, so what'd you think? He was like, man, I'm so mad at Bishop. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, man, such a liar. I was like, what do you mean he's a liar? There's no way God did all that stuff. He's embellishing that. That's a lie. He's making up stories. There's no way God did all that stuff. And I was like, bro, God did all that stuff. God moved. God showed up. There was favor, supernatural favor for everything that we see. God's hand on it. Incredible. There's always favor, whether in our families, in our lives, when we tap into the vision of God, of what God's trying to reveal to us, and if we want to actually get out of our seats and do it, there will be the favor that follows up every single time. Now, here's the thing. You might say, well, Pastor Marco, I have this vision, and I don't have the favor. Can I ask you a couple questions? Make a couple statements. Not trying to be harsh, because this is something I got to do for myself. Is it possibly not God's vision? Or is it possibly God's vision, but you're trying with your own strategy? And it's not God's strategy. Okay, God, trust me, I had those things with God. Like, God, with your youth, God, I don't know why I'm doing it. And he's like, dummy, stop striking the rock and speak to it. I'm doing a new thing, speaking, I'm striking. I'm like, man, I remember 3 years ago, I did this in youth ministry and 30 kids were saved and there was just transformation. And God's like, all right, I'll be here when you're done, okay? So a lot of times we try to accomplish what God wants our way and not his way, okay? Or we allow the opposition, the enemy, to come in and manipulate the circumstances, the situation, what's happening. And that goes into the third point here, looking at time. We need to realize opposition from the enemy will always accompany God's vision, God's calling. Always. It will always, always, always happen. Okay? If there's no opposition, we're just playing church. We're not the church. And I know you're like, how could you say that? Man, in Nehemiah, right? Immediately after, in chapter 2, after he gets this favor and the blessing from the king, it automatically says, two people started talking junk, okay? Two people started talking junk. In verse 10, it says, when Sanballat, the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Already taken notice. Now here's the deal. Nehemiah goes to the lands. He goes to Jerusalem, 150-mile trek, which back then, man, that's like going, you know, to California with a donkey, okay? He ends up going there. He ends up surveying the land, all this stuff, and then he tells the people why he's there and reveals the vision because they knew nothing about it. And guess what it says, okay? This is messed up. In verse 19, but when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite, official of Geshem the Arab, heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this you're doing, they asked. Are you rebelling against the king? What are they doing there? How did they get there? They weren't in Jerusalem. They heard. They were either, and it doesn't say exactly where they were, but I know they weren't in Jerusalem because they heard about before he revealed it to the people. When he got to Jerusalem, nobody knew when they were there. So if word got out so quickly that it got to Jerusalem that these guys found out about it, everybody else would have known. So either these dudes were in Persia and actually took the trip when they found out about it. That's how much hate they had. That's how much of an attack they were coming up against what God, that they followed. And if they didn't follow all the way from there, then that means they heard from a different province, usually where they were assigned. But since they were officials, they were most likely in the king's court also. And they traveled 150 miles to talk junk and to try to, you ever wonder like, yo man, why are you bothered? Why is this any concern of yours? You ever wonder that? Like, yeah, this is my family. Why are you on Facebook talking about me? Okay, where are you from? Okay, they're like, when was the last time I actually had a real conversation with you? And you, man, people coming after the things of God. Okay, guaranteed. So now, okay, in Nehemiah 4, it goes up a whole nother level. All right. In verse 8, it says they plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. In verse 11, it says, also our enemies said, before they know it or see us, they will we will be right there among them and will kill them and put an end to the work. If you go to chapter 6, it breaks down. They don't not just making threats. They're trying to plot to harm Nehemiah. They're giving false reports. They're sending false prophets in there. They're trying to influence the people within the house, within the church, the noblemen, and trying to get them on their side. They're going all after it, okay? Why do we blame God for the opposition? It's not God. If you're doing something right, expect the opposition. Expect it to come against you. And here's the thing. This leads to the fourth part. We need to be ready to fight. See, we need to be ready to fight. See, we're not ready to fight. Okay? In Nehemiah 4:9, it says, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. See, Nehemiah, when he heard this, he, first, what did he do? Prayed. What does prayer do? Revelation, insight, strategy. Same with the word of God today. Devotion, counsel. Okay, he got the plan. Okay, they're coming against. And then posted a guard. If you read in it, in verses 13 and 14, he knows the weaknesses of where stuff was built and fortified and where there's still holes in the wall, where there's gates still not up. In the lower parts where they can really easily attack, and he put them in there. Another part, he tells, if you continue reading in 4, he has them start shifts of who's gonna watch and guard Jerusalem. He has them, instead of going home, to start sleeping within the city. He has them, It says they're working with one hand and they have the sword in the other, ready. He says, and I'm not just making them do it. Me and my house and my noblemen and us, we're going to sleep with our clothes on. 52 days. They went to sleep just ready to hear the alarm go off, to hear the watchman just hit the alarm, and they were ready to go. It said even when they went for water, you guys ever watch, you know, any of those battle movies? I don't care if it's a Gladiator or anything. You know, they're in war. What they do when they go to the water, man, they take their armor off. They take their stuff off and then so they can get down and drink the water. It says even Nehemiah and his boys, they didn't even take it off to go drink water. They were always on their toes, ready for the fight. What good is it if we're willing to build our home but not guard it? How about this? The stuff we work so hard to build up, to give to our families, to give to our kids, is it the very thing the enemy uses to breach the gates, to breach the walls? What do I mean by that? That smartphone. Or for us, do we need to survey the land? Do we need to know where the threat is? Do we need to know our weaknesses? See, I need to know my weaknesses. And guess what? I'm a little clueless at times. My wife helps me with my weaknesses. Okay, Pastor Mike helps me with my weaknesses. Bishop helps me with my weaknesses. So that I can not be surprised, taken off, you know, off guard. We're off guard. Man, either in our home or in our ministry also. We need to be ready to fight. The last one, we all need to rebuild the wall together. See, Bishop is asking this simple question to us. On behalf of God, what part of the wall are you going to help rebuild? What part of the wall are you going to help rebuild? See, for me, I didn't want to preach this today. What I wanted to come and talk to you about today is I wanted to talk about breaking down the walls, community, you know, time of us how to come together. And that was, and God was like, no, that's not your role. See, last week I talked about my frustration when I first knew Bishop wasn't going to be here and how I was telling him. And I was like, Bishop, I want you to be here at least for the first couple of weeks. You need to bring the vision. And God showed me week one, nope, I have something else planned. And I embraced that. So then I thought now it was me and Pastor Mike. Okay, we're coming up. So now we're going to bring forth this clear vision with the strategy. See, I'm the pastor of operations. What does that mean? I love strategy. I love operations and the and putting it in order, X, Y, and Z. So I was ready, okay, God, showtime, I'm gonna come and do this, and the bishop's gonna hear it. He's gonna agree with it. Yeah, it's gonna be good, okay? And God was like, no, no. And I'm skipping by a lot of stuff here, but in order to build this wall, which we read in Nehemiah 3, all of the tribes came together. All of the tribes, there were some noblemen that didn't want to, but they came together in heart and in spirit. Isaiah 43 says this. So as I'm like, God, but I want to talk about strategy. God's like, no, here's what I'm talking. 43:18, forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. See, God's telling me, stop looking back. Stop trying to do it the way you think it needs to be done. I'm not calling you to come up with a strategy in this season. You're going to be a part of it. You might even be an integral part of it. But it's the people. I want them to raise up. I want them to stand up. So the challenge I put out last week, it's still out there. For us, when it comes to leadership in this house, there's one way to be part of the leadership of this house, and that's to serve. It's to serve. It's to get involved in the kingdom work, okay? And all of us that are involved, this is what I want you to do. I want you to talk to your leaders. I want you to press. I want you to fast. I want you to pray. I want you to get into the word. I want you, God, reveal to me. And then I want you to talk to your leader. If you work in the greeters, you're going to talk to Miss Pat. If you work in the children's ministry, you're going to talk to one of the coordinators, or you're going to talk to Minister Lee. If you're in the praise and worship team, you're with Minister Jason. So on and so forth. All these, you know who you serve under. And now we want to start talking about it. And here's the deal. We might not run with your idea. Don't get upset. Don't get offended. Here's the reality, okay? Here's the reality. We can deny, if we want to use that word, we can deny ideas. We can change around strategies. We can never deny the anointing. We can never deny the anointing. See, I mean, 1,000 ideas. I try to serve in 10 different ministries. I was on a sound ministry for like 3.5 minutes. And back then the leader said, no, Marco, you are tone deaf, be away. Okay, I was like, man. Okay, but guess what? I found my passion, I got that vision, and I started to serve. And that goes for the rest of us. We're like, well, I'm not serve the need. You heard it in this house 25 years ago, and today it's the same thing. Serve the need. If I have more time, I'll talk about the wall, but I can just imagine some famous blacksmiths in the town that wanted to create the ornate things for the wall and the clasp and the handles and all the stuff for the gates. And Nehemiah's like, that's great, but we have rubble that we need to take away. So I want you and your professional blacksmiths to get a couple shovels that you made and start shoveling that stuff out of here. And don't worry about it. There's going to be a time where we're going to use those giftings and you're going to make that beautiful gate, especially the sheep's gate, where they enter in with the sacrifice and what we're preparing for Jesus in the day to come, where he's going to walk out of here to the crucifixion. You know, that's a reference to that, the importance of that one gate. But my point is, God is calling us to get up, to get out, to exercise our voice. It's an encouraging word that says today in this house, we're all together. Let's stand with me. Let's close in prayer. There's so much more I wish I had time to talk to you about. I'm excited because next week, Lee's going to come and and this is the part of me that still struggles. So I'm like, oh, what is he going to say? Is he going to follow up? I want to do this. Maybe I should teach him. Like, no. Lee's coming next week to continue renewing the vision and the word to this house. I'm excited. This Wednesday coming up, Sandy's going to continue talking about the 2020. Okay? A life in focus. Come on out. And Wednesday night, and the youth, we're talking about it also. But right now, let's pray. Before we leave, just stop where you're at and let's just close in prayer right now. With your eyes closed, and the reason I say that is just for you to have a moment between you and God. I'm available. I said this last week, for the month of January, 30-minute meetings. Call the office, call Sarah, email me. But also, if it's not me, it's Pastor Mike. If it's not Pastor Mike, it's Earl for marriage ministry. It's Lauren for women's ministry. It's Lee for children. Just connect with your leaders and take a time to talk about these things. And let's get ready. Let's do it. But right now, before the Lord and together as one, if you can grab the hand of the person next to you, let's pray. Lord God, we can't do this by ourselves. We can't allow Bishop to try to do the vision and accomplish what you're calling kingdom life to not only be, but where kingdom life is going in the future by himself or with a few others. Lord God, I pray that we together, your church, would hear what you're speaking to us today and will press in beyond the noise, beyond the distractions, beyond the doubts, beyond even the deceptions, Lord God, and hear what you are speaking to us and be willing to be part and to answer that question. What part of the wall, Lord God? What part of the wall, Lord God, for me? What part of the wall for me and my family? What part of the wall are we going to rebuild? Let us press. Let us take days, weeks, months, whatever it takes, Lord God, that this year, Kingdom Life is rolling into the new season, the new things that you're promising through Isaiah 43. You're doing a new thing, Lord God. Have your way. In Jesus' precious name. Everybody said, amen. 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 Give it up to the Lord. Pastors and ministers.